for a muscle to do something, to contract, it needs to get a signal.
Yes.
The signal comes from the nerve comes down that, the signal comes down the nerve in the form of an action potential, an electrical signal. This is lightning fast.
So the electrical signal is first before the ventilation starts? When the ventilation happens here?
Ventilation, what ventilation?
The ventilation, you said the blue part is the ventilation. I mean, you said the blue part is the,
That's the myelin, that's the insulation.
Insulation, yeah, you said the blue part is the insulation.
Yeah, all that does is allows that electrical current to go down faster without interruption.
Oh, okay. So, okay, I get what you're saying.
And we call it insulation, because the thing with this way, think of it as a wire coming out of your TV into your TV. It has that plastic around it. What if it didn't have that plastic around it?
You can get electrocuted fast.
Because the electricity going through there, you could accidentally touch it, that could interrupt the signal from here to here, so you have to have something around it.
So
the electricity is not interrupted. So you kind of think of it this way, we call it insulation because it does the same thing. It keeps that signal from getting interrupted, so it zips down to here very, very quickly, but it zips in a leapfrog pattern, which keeps it nice and stable. Now, here's the thing about neurons. They're going to get a signal from another neuron. So here, this is going to be that terminal axon or terminal bouton that we see over here from another neuron. We know that there's going to be an action potential that's going to come all the way down to here. And of course, we're going to have some kind of neurotransmitter in here that's going to be released. And in this case, it's going to bind to receptors, just like with the muscle, except the receptors here on the nerve.
What bone is this with
me? Wait, what?
What bone is this?
This isn't a bone. This is a neuron. This is a cell.
Oh, okay.
This is the end of a cell.
Oh, all right.
An end of a neuron here. I just enlarged it.
Okay.
So this is another neuron coming from here. The signal is leapfrogging down very, very quickly. When it gets to the end, it releases neurotransmitter, just like with the muscle. And then that binds to receptors on the next cell, just like with the muscle. That causes sodium to come in, just like with the muscle. But now that transforms it into an electrical signal again.
Oh, and I'll go to the body.
That electrical signal now goes to the body of the cell, the body of the neuron. Here, it decides, what do we do with it? Do we forget about it? Do we keep it? Do we send it along? If it decides to send it along, it sends it here, or it goes down that axon to meet these other neurons, where that signal is then going to be released from here onto receptors there, which is going to cause that signal to continue. This is how our brain works too. The neurons in our brain work like this. It's actually very simple. The neurons in our brain get information that comes in as some kind of signaling. And then that's going to become, if it's not already, that electrical signal, which is then going to be transferred into a chemical signal, which then gets transferred into an electrical signal again, which then comes to the end here, transferred to a chemical signal again, which changes into an electrical signal again. What that means is everything you know is just the result of a chemical message becoming an electrical message, becoming a chemical message, becoming an electrical message. Everything you think is an electrical message becoming a chemical message, becoming an electrical message, becoming a chemical message, becoming an electrical message. Every thought you have, every feeling you have, love, hate, frustration, happiness, is an electrical message, becoming a chemical message, becoming an electrical message, becoming a chemical message, becoming an electrical message again. Every image that you see in your head, if it's the picture of your mother, if it's the picture, if it's the image of the school you went to when you were in third grade, or if it's the image of a purple elephant wearing a pink cowboy hat walking across the parking lot, which you've never, ever seen before, but right now in your head, you can imagine a purple elephant wearing a pink cowboy hat walking across the parking lot. All of those things are the result of an electrical message that becomes a chemical message, that becomes an electrical message, becomes a chemical message, becomes an electrical message. And that's what we know. And that's about it.
And when one of those off, that's still considered the chemical imbalance.
The problem with this, when you say that, is we just talked about muscle physiology. And muscle physiology is the route of electrical current becoming a chemical, becoming electrical, becoming a chemical, becoming electrical, becoming a chemical, which is then going to activate the electrical inside of the muscle, which becomes a chemical again. So it could be argued that everything in the body is the result of chemical reactions. And when things in the body don't go well, it's because of a change in those chemical reactions, which is why I said in the beginning, when you understand cell physiology, medicine becomes inevitable, because it's all those chemical reactions that are happening at the cell level, at the cellular level, that controls everything in the body. People think that somehow when they say chemical imbalance is just in the head. No, chemical imbalance can happen anywhere in the body. It can mess up anything.
So my initial question was, because everything is, for a better term, is motivated by glucose, why does this release sodium?
Well, in order for this nerve to function, what's it got to make?
You said sodium.
No. What's this nerve, what's this cell have to make? Proteins and what? Every cell makes two things in the body. It makes energy and it makes proteins. In order for this cell to work, it has to be able to make energy and it has to be able to make proteins.
But I thought the
How do we make energy?
Through sugar.
Glucose, oxygen, and some water. Which means those cells in our nerves have to get glucose, oxygen, and water in order for them to continue to function. In our brain, those cells have to get glucose, oxygen, and water in order to make energy for those nerves to function. If this cell right here, just this one, didn't get any glucose, oxygen, and water, what's going to happen to this cell?
Probably not.
The very first thing it's going to do is it's going to slow down. Everything's going to slow down. So when that signal comes from here to here, what's going to happen to that signal going through it? Is it going to be increased or decreased?
Decreased.
And then eventually it's going to die, which means when that signal comes from here to here, what's going to happen?
No sodium.
Nothing's going to happen.
Yeah.
It's going to stop, which means whatever's supposed to happen down here isn't supposed to happen.
Oh, okay.
This is why I said
okay.
When people have low blood sugar, they complain of things like mental dullness, because then they start thinking, I can't think straight. Really? No kidding.
Got it. Maybe they need the
yes.
energy. I got it.
So do we also need sodium?
Yes.
Yes, we do. Remember I said how important sodium is, so we have to have sodium in our blood.
Or
optimal. What?
Or drinking.
No, not to stop it. Not to drink. Shut up. We need to have that sodium for these reactions to occur. So let me ask you this. In fact, going back to the muscle physiology for instance, remember that acetylcholine comes across the neuromuscular junction, binds to those receptors, and then sodium can come in, cause a contraction? What do you think would happen if we somehow blocked sodium from going in? If we blocked those receptors from picking up the acetylcholine, sodium would come in.
It wouldn't contract.
Wouldn't contract. What does that sound like to you?
A spasm.
No. Just the opposite.
No.
What's the opposite of contraction?
Relaxation.
Relaxation.
Oh.
And what type of tissue are we talking about?
Flexing.
Not nerves.
The
muscle. So what kind of medications would those be called that would block the sodium
muscle
channels? Look at that. So muscle relaxers are going to be medications. They're either going to block somewhere along the nerve sending them down, or it's going to block it right at that muscle. We block those receptors, acetylcholine won't bind. So even if a signal is going down to the muscle saying contract, 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 it will never get past that point because it's releasing acetylcholine, but there's no receptors there. We've blocked them all.
Okay.
We block the receptors, no sodium goes in, no contraction occurs. Relaxation. Can't be that easy.
I have two questions.
Mm-hmm.
The one was actually drawn a blank underneath. The girl who left, it was her question from the other day of how is a pinched nerve created?
Yes.
And then my other question is, in a patient who is manic, does that have to do with the neurons in the brain? And if you could explain that.
Okay, question number one. We're talking about nerves, pinched nerves, meaning that pain that we feel in parts of our body because a nerve is being impinged upon. Remember, this right here, sending the signal down, which sends it to the next one, sends it to the next one, sends it down the chain like this. It's also or up to the brain. What can happen is those signals that are coming back to the brain are normal, 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 and somebody sticks you with a pin, those signals suddenly is going to be pain, 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 pain. It's going to go up your brain, so how that hurts. So what happens when somebody has a pinched nerve is somewhere along the way, the nerve is literally getting impinged upon, which causes the areas around here to suddenly just spontaneously depolarize. In other words, it just creates this signal from nothing. It just creates it.
Yeah.
And then now that created signal is going to come down now or up, 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 up to the brain as pain.
Wow.
So if we take away that impingement, it won't go up to the brain. But remember, the sensation of pain is still felt in the brain. The brain itself does not feel pain, but the sensation of pain in our body is still felt up here. That's why people can have their foot amputated, have their whole left leg amputated from below the knee, but they can still feel pain in that big toe.
Really?
Because
isn't that like
the brain, yes, because the brain is still getting like a signal saying, yeah, there's pain there. So when I talk about pain coming up the nerve, is that pain, when you step on a tack, is that pain is making its way up? You don't feel the pain when that signal is coming up to here. You don't feel the pain yet. You don't feel the pain yet. You don't feel the pain yet. You don't feel it till it gets to the spinal cord and then up to the brain. And in fact, when you first step on it for that brief second, you'll take your foot off before you feel the pain because it'll go up to the spinal cord, which will send a signal quickly back, says lift your foot up, and the signal goes to the brain, says you just step on a tack. So the pain part is actually felt up here. The spinal cord can recognize this pain, but not interpret it to you as pain yet. That's what your brain has to do. Your brain has to do the interpretation part of it. Then, your other question about mania. If this is my brain, and this signal comes down here, releases this neurotransmitter across the space and binds to these receptors, and creates this nice, powerful signal of happiness. If it gets down here and then suddenly this just releases an enormous amount of that neurotransmitter, then the signal that's here of happiness is going to be super, super signal of happiness, which means when it gets down to here, it's going to release a huge amount of that neurotransmitter, super, super happiness. So all we have to do, just like what I was talking about with those drugs for muscle relaxation, is block the receptors here. So we don't have to necessarily get rid of this. All we have to do is block the receptors so that instead of getting a huge, huge, huge signal, it just gets the normal happy signal. Now, what if a person wasn't getting enough of a happy signal? I want you to go back to, in your head, the muscle physiology picture. Remember we had that guy, that cholinesterase Pac-Man guy, cleaning up, recycling? We have him here, similar.
Mm-hmm.
We have him here, similar, doing the same job. In this case, we'll call him serotonin reuptake inhibitor, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, in fact. And he's taking up that extra, but there's not a lot that's being delivered. So I'm not getting any happy signal past this point. So if there's only a little bit being delivered as it is, and there's no happy signal, and that guy's still coming through and recycling, what if we block the recycler? So that, just like with the myasthenia gravis, if we block that recycler, then this is going to stay here for longer, which means it's going to continue to activate those receptors longer, which means that signal is going to be stronger. We call those selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or SSRIs, we have heard it that way. And that's going to create a stronger signal of happiness. Or if I eat chocolate like a Twix bar, that creates a huge signal of happiness here, all the way to my toes. It's a huge happy, all over happiness. It's magical. This is the most basic understanding. Now, here's where we get confused. Here's what we don't know, because this is easy. We got this. This is simple. Electrical becomes chemical, becomes electrical, becomes chemical. We know there's sodium channels there that allow sodium. We know the different neurotransmitters that are going to be released. Easy. The question is, how does that electrical signal that becomes a chemical suddenly become a picture in your brain? Or how does it become the answer to the question, how much is 4 plus 5? You know it's 9, right? Okay. How did that happen? How did a signal that's an electrical signal, that's all it is, purely positives and negatives, which releases a neurotransmitter, which just binds to a receptor, it doesn't go into the cell, it just binds right here, and then that turns it back into that electrical signal again. How does that become a picture in your head?
It's what we perceive it, how we, which one we tell to release.
Okay, how do we perceive it? That's what I'm asking you. How does that actually happen? How does perception occur?
Based on, I guess, how you would interpret it.
No, interpretation is perception is the same thing. You can't just keep saying the same thing over and over. What's how you see it in your head?
Yeah,
I know. That's the question that we don't have an answer to.
Would it be learned?
No, that's because that's still just perception, interpretation.
Did you
we still don't have an answer.
Did you say blind people can still have this?
Blind people can only see if they saw before.
That's what I thought. That's
yes. If they were born where they had vision and they lost their vision,
so,
if they had a dream, they could see in their dream.
So wouldn't it make sense to say that the neurons, when they're sending nerves, they send, you know, signal to the brain, which interacts with, you
the
know,
brain
memory.
Is the neurons.
Yes, I'm sorry. So, like, the brain interacts with, like, your memory center, and...
But the memory center is just made up of neurons.
Oh, so you're asking where does the picture come from?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Experience?
Is no.
Oh, you just don't. We
I'm
don't
telling
know.
You.
We
just
well,
don't know.
We create picture with our sight and then we store
no, we
it.
Don't.
I mean, I,
no,
I
we don't. No,
we
don't create a picture with our sight.
Our sight,
our sight is just a bunch of switches that are in the back of our eyeball, just like light switches. And just like you have a room that's huge with a whole bunch of different light switches. And you know you go into that room, you turn on this light, but not that light, but this light, and this light, but not that light, this light. So you have the stage lit up in this part, but not this part, and the overheads are on, but not those over here. The same thing happens in our inside of our eyeballs. They're just switches. And so as light comes in, those switches either get switched on or they don't get switched on. So depending upon which switches get switched on and which don't get switched on, all that information is gathered just by a nerve, which is just a bunch of these all bundled together in a straight line, goes back to our brain and actually crosses over. Part of it crosses over, goes to either side. And back here in this lobe of our brain, what would that lobe of our brain be called back
occipital.
Here? I would call it the occipital lobe because it's right by the occipital bone. The occipital lobe of our brain right back here is where our brain creates the image. But how?
Don't ask
no
me.
Idea. We
out.
Might not be smart enough to ever know the answer to this.
Somebody.
We might be too stupid to ever be able to figure it out. Yes, that's
if
how
we figured
complicated
all this out,
it is.
It'll come
this is the easy part. This is simple. And no, we do not. We do not only use 38% of our brain, we use 100% of our brain. We just don't use it at the same time. Now, what would happen if we did use it at the same time? Would we be smarter?
You would be like being a superhuman. You said I was superhuman.
That's
why.
We would have super intelligence.
What doctor told you that?
We would go crazy.
Not
no.
Our body would be like.
No, we would be dumber. Why don't we use all of our brain at the same time?
Because we have to focus on
something
at a time.
Right, because we have to focus. Sometimes we have to focus more on memory. Sometimes we have to focus more on vision. Sometimes we have to focus more on other types of thought. So our brain selects which areas that we're going to use and puts the most energy there, or at least the most fuel for the energy. So if we have a certain amount of fuel and it's only going here and only going here and only going here, but suddenly we started using all of our brain, now we got to take that amount of fuel and divvy it up to everybody. Which means every cell gets less fuel, which means every cell is going to run slower. So you'd actually be dumber if you used all of your brain at the same time. Contrary to what you see in movies, there's a really good movie about
Lucy.
This. Yeah, great movie.
Yes,
that's my movie.
That's
cool movie.
Yeah.
Loved it. I've watched it a dozen times. Awesome movie. Nothing real about it at all. Because that's not how the brain works at all. And it would never be able to function like that. So stop getting your scientific information from movies. Watch the movies for entertainment, enjoyment, not for science.
What do you mean?
I know. Okay, go ahead.
How much should I feel?
Why would you want to do that when you could just do this?
Because I don't care to, like, oh my gosh, that would be so cool.
Why?
It would make life easier.
Why?
Because we might have to move.
She'd be a fat blob just lying around telekinetically bringing cheeseburgers to your mouth.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is a perfect example.
Yes.
That's, and unfortunately, it's a perfect example of why it wouldn't make your life easier. It'd probably be just the opposite.
Yeah, make it shorter. You're right.
Don't do that. Okay. Do you realize, we talked about a little bit this before, you realize that when you dream, you're not discovering the future. Nothing like that is happening. Your dreams don't tell the future. Your dreams are a way that your brain exercises and decides what information is important to keep and what information is ready to be discarded. That's what it is. There's no such thing as deja vu. There's no such thing as deja vu.
What?
Yes, there is.
There's no such thing as deja vu.
I thought it was the sensation of deja vu.
But if it's not, I'm sorry, it's not actually telling the future. You were in some parallel life.
Oh, man.
Nothing like that. I know you don't have superpowers.
I thought it was your subconscious.
It's the brain. It's not your subconscious. It's your brain making a mistake. That's
it.
My brain got big mistakes.
Yes. And that's just it. The thing is, you're not going to doubt it because it's your brain. Why would you doubt your brain? You see, what happens is you see something in an environment that reminds you of another environment. So you go on that first date with that guy and he takes you to an Italian restaurant you've never been to before, you've never been with this guy before, and there's music playing in the background. And on the table is this red checker cloth. You don't really stand there and go, look at the red checker cloth. But your brain sees it, and your brain recognizes that pattern. And it was the exact same pattern that was on your grandmother's tablecloth back when you were growing up all those years ago. And as soon as your brain sees that pattern, it says, I remember this. So the brain says, I remember this. Therefore, I remember this. Therefore, I remember this. And I remember this. And all of this happened before. Remember? And then your brain says, yes, I do remember it happening before.
Yeah, that's funny.
But it didn't.
Wait, so.
It's not a glitch in the matrix.
So how I experienced deja vu, or what I call deja vu?
Well, it is a thing called deja vu, but it's not you telling the future.
It's like, just the other day, I was asking you a question, and when you started responding, my brain was like, whoa, I heard that.
Yes.
Like, the exact same conversation we were having.
Yes.
Was playing out again.
Yes. But you ever notice when you're doing that deja vu thing, when that happens to you, never once do you catch the vase from falling? Back to the Matrix. Never once do you go, oh my God, I remember this whole thing. In fact, I would have knocked that over and dropped it. Never once in that, you're like, oh my God, I remember this whole conversation. He's just about to say, three spark. Yes, I remember that. You don't go, and wait, in just a moment, he's going to say, Twix bars are delicious and it's the best thing for your body. And there it is. It's never like that. It's always just as it happens that your brain says, yes, and that's it. And then that happened, and this happened. Yeah, sorry. It's not the future. It's the present. Your brain's just making a mistake. And who are you going to believe? It's your brain, after all. Of course you're going to believe it. Mm-hmm.
Don't let this distract from the fact that deja vu is really real.
And then he's 49 years old.
A birthmark, by the way, is not how you die in the past life. So tell you that question, that's in the book.
No, I never heard that.
That was in the book.
I heard that.
I heard your mom
ate
something hot and it burned your skin.
Oh my god.
You never heard that?
Oh,
hot chips during pregnancy is not good.
You're like a pancake monster.
It looked like a taco roll.
Oh my gosh, it looks like the bell.
See, her mom ate hot chips.
I love it.
Where does taste occur, by the way?
In your
taste buds?
Nope.
Do you smell your taste?
In your taste buds.
Taste does not occur on your taste buds. Taste occurs in your brain. Those taste buds are just little tiny switches. They either get switched on or they do not get switched on. And that signal gets sent to your brain and it's interpreted in taste.
Same thing as a tongue burn.
No, that's totally different. That's actually a tongue burn. I can't. Theoretically, we could get a patient who's still alive, cut their calvary off, go into their brain, get a little wire probe, stick it in just the right part of their parietal lobe,
right,
and give it a shock, and the patient would say, I taste chocolate. Taste occurs up here, not on the tongue. Vision occurs back here, not in the eyes. Where do you think hearing occurs?
In your brain.
Getting a little obvious now, isn't it? Yes.
Hearing
does not happen in the ears. There's just switches. It actually happens in the temporal lobe. That's where the hearing part happens. Like you heard that train out there. But then you're also hearing my speech. So the first part of that hearing goes to the temporal lobe of your brain and says that's human speech. And then it goes to the area of the parietal near the frontal lobe that says, now I'm understanding the words that Dr. Sturgeon are saying to me. That's where the speech center is located, up in there. So just because you're hearing here doesn't mean you're actually understanding what's being said. That's just the first part of hearing. Where do you think you smell?
In your brain.
When
you say cocoa, when I'm sick, I can't taste my food sometimes. So is it like in my brain that I'm not tasting?
No.
So why would I taste it? If it's just in my head,
I know. Here's what I want you to do. Get your hand like this. Fingers closed. They have to be closed tightly. Now put them over your eyes. Now look at me. Do you see me?
No.
Okay, does that mean something's wrong with your brain?
No.
No, that means there's something wrong with the images coming into this part.
Yeah.
So if there's something that interrupts the image coming into this part, well then yeah, it's never going to make a vision of the back of your head. So yeah, you could have a problem with your tongue. I could cut somebody's tongue off,
okay,
and they're never going to taste another meal again because they're never going to have that ability to get those taste buds activated, the switches activated, to send the signal to the brain. That's just oftentimes an interruption between this part until it gets to, wait, parietal lobe, until it gets this part of the brain where you're actually tasting it.
So that means there's something wrong with me when I'm sick and I can't taste food?
Somehow interfering with your taste buds.
That's not normal. Did
that
happen to you?
No,
yes,
it happens.
Like my mom. Because if there's a lot of mucus and a lot of swelling, then all those switches don't get activated.
Don't you taste somewhat because of your sense of smell as well?
That's what I thought too.
Well,
you taste your smell.
You don't taste your smell because they're different. But remember, once it gets to the brain, we have a part in our brain that puts things together.
Right.
This is why you can walk into somebody else's house and go, it smells like my grandmother's house. Or you can eat some lasagna, and then you're suddenly reminded of sitting in that restaurant with that tablecloth and the band playing.
What if you eat something and you're like, wow, this tastes like the smell of?
Yeah, because when you smell something, I'm trying to think of a food that has a really good. What does a chocolate chip cookie taste smell like? It smells like a chocolate chip cookie. You know that smell. What does it taste like?
It tastes like a chocolate chip cookie.
So when you put that in your body says, this is the taste of chocolate chip cookie, this is the smell of chocolate chip cookie. So as you're doing both of these things together, you are smelling that chocolate chip cookie as you're tasting it.
Oh.
So you're getting both of those things at the same time coming into your brain that are making that connection saying these go together.
I mean, like,
but that wouldn't have happened if you've never tasted a chocolate chip cookie. If all you did was smell and never tasted it, that would never have happened.
I was going to say, because there's certain things, though, where I'm like, it's something that's like inedible or something that just has a scent or something, and I'm like, wow, this tastes like the scent of this.
Yeah,
like,
the brain makes that connection. It says, it reminds me of this.
Gotcha.
Yeah, just like, and one thing the brain really, really likes is coincidence. It likes when things are connected in some way, when they go together. Which is why it's easier to remember the name of somebody that you like versus the name of somebody that you're really indifferent about. This is why when you wake up in the morning after having that dream that your best friend called you, and you have a best friend from 6 years ago, you haven't talked to them in 5 years, and then you had a dream, they called you, and the next day they suddenly call you. It's magical, it's witchcraft. No, it's a coincidence, and your brain likes that. You forget all of the other times where you dreamt about that person calling you or some other person calling you, excuse me, and they never call. Or you didn't have a dream, but they didn't call. So there's no connection to make, so your brain just forget those. But when there is a connection, aha, I must somehow have secret powers.
So when it comes to like remembering your dreams and stuff, and how you basically forget your dream as soon as you wake up, is it the same thing where like you'll see or do or smell something later that day and you're like, you suddenly remember what dream you had? Okay.
Right, one last question about teeth. Have you heard, like, after certain medications, you might have a metallic taste or procedures,
you
have a metallic taste in your mouth?
Yes.
Good question.
Don't know. Don't know how it's connected. Because sometimes people have said things like, before having a stroke, they would have a metallic taste, or they would have, they would smell burning toast.
Yeah.
How that's connected is still kind of unclear. Kind of like, I think we talked about, I don't know if we talked, maybe we didn't talk about it. When people have an iron deficiency and they want to chomp on ice, yes, that does happen. Why? It's still not really clear.
Is that just about